This is Folkscene. I'm Howard Larman. Our guest is Nanci Griffith.
Great to be here.
It's good to have you come back.
Yes.
Really. Would you start with a song?
Sure. This is a song that was written by Eric Taylor called Deadwood, South Dakota. Deadwood Saloon, South Dakota afternoon, where the old ones by the door with their heads to their chest, they told lies about whiskey on a woman's breast. Yes, and some tell the story of young Mickey Free, who lost an eye to a buck deer in the Tongue River Valley. Oh, and some tell the story of California Joe, who sent word through the Black Hills there was a mountain of gold. And the gold she lay cold in their pockets, and the sun she sets down on their cheeks, and they thank the Lord for the land that they live in, where the white man does as he pleases. Some flat-shoed fool from the east comes a-running with some news that he'd read in some St. Joseph paper, and it was drinks all around, 'cause the news he was telling was the one they'd called crazy, had been caught and been dealt with. And in the Easterner, he read the news from the paper, and the old ones gathered closer so they could hear better. And it says here the crazy horse was killed while he was trying to escape, and it was sometime last September, and it don't give the exact date. Whiskey and women and cold nights on the plains, Lord, and fighting those Indians. And the Easterner, he says he'll have one more before he goes. He gives the paper to the crow boy who sweeps up the floor.
Must be a special feeling for a writer to have somebody of your writing talent record their song.
Well, it's a special feeling for me to record Eric Taylor's songs because Eric and I were married some 10 years ago or whatever, and he was one of the people who really taught me that writing music is an art, and it has a specific goal to it and should be like little short stories, and he reinforced that with me and taught me a lot about guitar, and so recording his songs has always been a very special feeling.
You've recorded a number of his songs earlier.
Yeah.
Our guest is Nanci Griffith, and her latest album is on MCA. Last two albums are on MCA, Lone Star State of Mind and Little Love Affairs. And the other four albums are still available on Round or Philo.
Correct, yeah.
I have to tell you something. I have to share something with you because everybody says the same thing about Nanci Griffith is they had anticipated, I think, when you moved to MCA Records, to a major label, that that was going to affect what you sounded like on record and that you're nothing distracted from Nanci Griffith. And I'm so pleased with those albums. I love them.
Well, it's really been, MCA has been so kind to me, and Tony Brown, my co-producer at MCA, that was his main goal, was not to change anything about Nanci Griffith when we started out on, you know, producing these albums, and they've pretty much given me creative leeway, and of course, much to the chagrin of country radio, my music hasn't changed. You know, it's still not the slick spit and polish of what you normally hear on country radio, but it's still country music, still folk music, still hillbilly music, all wrapped into one.
It is interesting, too, that you and a number of your friends, like Steve Earle, who I talked to, refer to their music as folk music. And some years ago, the major labels were trying to tell their artists, don't say that about your music. But aside from doing the records and manufacturing them and getting them out there, they don't really interfere with what you're doing, right? It's just
no, they really don't. You know, they've pretty much just left me to my own devices, you know, and they've never said, oh, you can't record that song or... the only thing that they have control over that I don't is choosing what is a single and when the single is released. I've never had any control over that. But other than that, you know, it's still my product. The single is still from my product, you know. So.
Are the singles made differently than what's on the versions that are on the album like sometimes happens?
No, not really. We don't even remix. We haven't even, you know, done anything like that. I know Steve Earle has... They've remixed something for a single, you know, but we never have gotten around to doing that. Maybe that's why I don't have hit records. I don't know.
Well, that's another thing, and I mean, you're young, and you've been at this a long time, and for a lot of us, we kept saying, "Boy, Nanci Griffith is going to be a big star," and it's, but your following is building real slow and steady, isn't it? It hasn't come with one big bang, like.
No, it hasn't. It's been a very nice process. A very, you know, it's almost like audiences have brought their friends, and those friends have met new friends, and from that, it's really built around this country. We've had somewhat, I guess, what you would call overnight success in Europe, in England, and Ireland, and that's startling. You know, I can't imagine what it would. You know, be like to have that across the board overnight success. It's frightening in some ways. So I've always been very comfortable with slow, steady upward climb. You know, you got to come back down the hill at some point. It's best not to tumble down it. You
know? Our guest is Nanci Griffith, and she's on MCA Records. How about another song?
Sure. This is a song off of the Little Love Affairs album, and the Little Love Affairs album is songs all about couples. And of all the couples on the Little Love Affairs album, this couple is the sleaziest couple of all. This is a couple who owns a hotel on the New Jersey shore in the 1940s. It's called Love Wore a Halo. She ran the numbers and she ran her clean.
you were looking for love, boy, she could have found it to 44. It's love for a halo back for the war. When the men love the women and the women knew what me had before, that's for sure. When the men love the women and the women knew what me had before, and that's what Nancy Reagan would say. When the men love the women and the women knew what men were for.
Nancy, share a little bit about the way you write a song. What is the process? How does it? Do you make a lot of notes, or you sit down one time and crank one out? Or
well, they come in different stages. When I wrote "Love Wore a Halo," I was playing in Atlantic City with the Everly Brothers, and so we were actually there on the Jersey Shore, and all of us had the flu, and we were all a bit delirious. But even with the flu and half dead and doing two shows a night in Atlantic City, we were all still hanging around in the casinos, spending our money and trying to win that one more slot machine, you know. And the characters came up for "Love Wore a Halo," and they are also, you know, the subject of a novel I'm working on now. So inspiration comes from around every bend. I mean, it just comes when it comes. Yeah.
I would think being on the road and working that hard that be almost impossible to find time to sit down and actually work on a song. So is it composed there, or is it just...
Well,
notes, or?
there's a lot of time on the road when you don't want to go sightseeing. You've bought every piece of clothing you could ever want in your life, and you sit down in your hotel room with your guitar, and that's your friend, and that's your companion, and you release all of this information that you've stored in a file cabinet in your head the whole time you're on the road from all of these characters that you meet out on the street every day.
You've been performing for a long time, haven't you? Heard? Real young when you started performing.
They're 20 years now. I guess I was 14 when I started.
What kind of songs were you singing at 14?
At 14, I guess I was singing a few of my own songs. I was singing a lot of Woody Guthrie songs. Country songs, like real old school country songs. Just kind of a combination of hillbilly and country, just all kinds of things. I never did sing any really traditional folk ballads. That was real long-haired stuff for me. You know, I tended to lean towards Carolyn Hester and Loretta Lynn's school of music, you know. And it was always something with a little bit of punch to it that I was singing.
In the articles that have been written about you, and I'm talking about not the recent ones, but the older ones, Carolyn Hester keeps popping up. Is that a major influence on you?
Very much major influence. I guess the two women, you know, as women performers that have influenced my career the most would be Carolyn Hester and Loretta Lynn. Carolyn Hester was my first favorite vocalist, you know, and Loretta was the first female that I ever saw who wrote her own songs, you know, who was not just a girl singer. She wrote her own dadgum songs, you know. And both of them have, you know, really been prominent. I think it's audible in the music. You can hear it there.
I don't think so much anymore.
I still hear it. Yeah. You know, I still sing a song like 40 Connellyne and I Can Hear Loretta, you know, and sing a song like There's a Light Beyond These Woods, Mary Margaret, and I Can Hear Carolyn in there, you know.
Our guest is Nanci Griffith, and you can hear Nanci Griffith on her own albums on MCA, the last two, Little Love Affairs and Lone Star State of Mind. And there's four previous albums, and they're all good. We argue among ourselves which one we think is the best, but I change my mind from day to day, I think. I'd be hard-pressed if I had to make a choice between any of them.
Well, I know that, well, currently my favorite one, as we speak here, the new album is coming out. It's a live album that we recorded down in Houston called One Fair Summer Evening. And it's the requests and the favorites of the fans from live shows, what they yell for, and letters that they've written. And for years, people have been writing and asking me for a live acoustic album. And this is it. This is their Christmas present from Nanci Griffith. And And it's just me on guitar and my keyboard player, James Hooker, on keyboards. And we did it at Anderson Fair in Houston, Back to the Red Brick Floor, mm-hmm. for the fans of the Spin on a Red Brick Floor song from the Once in a Very Blue Moon album. And so that's real exciting for me. I'm anxious for that to come out.
How about another song?
Sure. In fact, I'll do one on guitar that is normally the keyboard song of the evening, and this is the Julie Gold song. It's made friends for me around the world and done special things for me. It's called From a Distance.
From a distance, the world looks blue and green, and the snow-capped mountains wave. And from a distance, the ocean meets the stream, and the eagle takes to fly. From a distance, there is harmony, and it echoes through. And it's the voice of hope, it's the voice of peace, it's the voice of every man. And from a distance, we all have enough, and no one is in need. And there are no guns, no.
Such a good song, and you do it so well.
Thank you.
Is drama in your background at all, and acting?
A little bit. When I was a kiddo, my mom was an amateur actress, and she was always involved with the Civic Theater in Austin, Texas. And so I was in a few plays. When they needed a kid my age, they would mm-hmm. get my mom to bring me in. I was in Little Abner and Gypsy and Dracula and couple of weird things, you know.
Mm-hmm. Was that just to fill in, or did you actually study some acting?
Well, I studied a little bit, but I really enjoyed the music, you know, much more. Though I love the stage and enjoyed all of the companionship and the camaraderie of being in an actual play and doing the same, you know, the spontaneity of having to create the same thing every night with a fresh quality to it was always a challenge.
Now, I find this hard to believe, but some of my friends that came back from the recent Strawberry Bluegrass Festival said that you have even more personality on stage than you had in previous times. And I've always enjoyed your stage performance so much, I couldn't think of how it could be better. Is it telling the stories and introducing the songs? Is that a real challenge, isn't it?
I think so. That's always been the fun part for me. That's kept the music fresh for me. Is the stories and that little patter back and forth with the audience. On the new live album, we left that in, which is fun, you know. But it's also keeping those stories fresh. I've never told the same story exactly the same way twice. Mm-hmm. And some stories, only make one tour and then there's a new story. Mm-hmm. So it changes, you know. There's a constant turnover in it.
Tell me about the taking the band on the road. That was a new experience since the last time I saw you anyway. I saw you at the Roxy with the band.
Mm-hmm.
I can understand where it can be both limiting in that you have to sort of stick to the set,
mm-hmm.
but it's also freeing because you don't have to work so much as a guitarist.
That's very true. I have learned a lot more about being a rhythm guitar player, being in the band, because mm-hmm. I am the rhythm guitar player. And I think all the band members as well have learned a lot about working with a rhythm guitar player who also plays lead. To stay off my lead, you know. it's a good challenge, and I love my band. I have now the band members have changed a little bit since the Roxy, and the Blue Moon Orchestra that is together now is something very special. We have a drummer from Dublin, Ireland now named Fran Breen, who is just incredible. And, of course, James Hooker is an original member of my Blue Moon Orchestra. He's been with me for 2 years now, and he was the founding member of the Amazing Rhythm Aces. And he brought us Bird Burton, who played guitar and steel and dobro and everything for the Amazing Rhythm Aces. So now we have two Amazing Rhythm Aces band members in our band, as well as Denny Bixby on bass and harmony.
Our guest is Nanci Griffith. She's on MCA Records. And a new album coming out shortly. How about another song?
Sure. Be glad to. A new song. All right. This is a song that I co-wrote with James Hooker from the band. And it's a song called I Don't Want to Talk About Love Now. So. Hear it in a disco midnight shouting. And I don't want to think about it. Come dressed and it's summer clothes when you're traveling through the heart of the winter's cold. And I don't want to talk about changes. Changes come on their own free will. If you want to talk about leaving where you always walked and you always will. And every time you talk about love, well, you talk about your yesterdays. And yesterday's washing away with this morning's rain. And I don't want to talk about it, cause love has a voice of its own. All we do is try to outshout it, and the love is gone. And I don't want to talk about love now. I don't want to talk about love now. And I don't want to talk about love. Love the night. It's always been a quiet voice
this love was my saving grace. So can't I just say that I love you and we'll call it a day? 'Cause I don't wanna talk about love now, and I don't wanna talk about love now, and I don't wanna talk about love now. I don't wanna talk about love now.
From time to time on your albums, we run into songs that are co-written, but that's not that usual for you to write with somebody, is it?
It's real rare, actually. It happens maybe once an album, you know. I've been real fortunate to have met James Hooker. He has become like the missing ingredient to writing for Nanci Griffith. We co-wrote two things for Little Love Affairs, both the title track and a song called Gulf Coast Highway that's a duet song. And we've written four songs this year together. So we've really been on a roll of finding each other, you know, which is great. Mm-hmm. He doesn't write any lyrics, and I write very little of the music on just the things we've co-written, you know. So it's a good combination because I love writing lyrics.
Our guest is Nanci Griffith. The new album, you said, only has two things that you didn't previously record.
Right. It has the Deadwood, South Dakota song that I did earlier, Song of Eric's, and a song that's a brand new song of mine called I Would Bring You Ireland.
Oh, maybe that's why I've seen a couple of references referring to Nanci Griffith, Irish folk singer or something.
Oh, really?
Yeah. You want to do that song?
Sure, be glad to. Yeah.
I would bring you Ireland, the cool sweet of the Dublin rain. If you would keep my heart for me in the quiet of your Texas days and my old. Will you shelter me from pain? And in return, I'd bring you Ireland. One day I'll build a tower high up on my Texas plains, where I can see from coast to coast on hot days when the dust is still and the cotton prays for rain and the thirsty passes by wonder why they came. I dreamed of Amarillo on a foreign night in Dublin. The dust was on my when the raindrops started falling in a hotel window where I could see his rainbow. And I thought I'd send my heart to you, 'cause that's the way the wind blows. And I'll reclaim my heart one day. We'll sit and watch your children play. And I will bring them lullabies for summer days and back porch nights. And my old friend, we will always meet again. Then I will bring you Ireland. And I will bring you Ireland.
Our guest is Nanci Griffith. Maybe I contributed to that thing because that tune that on Little Love Affairs that you do with James Hooker,
right,
that sounds Irish.
Uh-huh.
I played it in the middle of a set of Irish music because it just fit right.
Oh boy, I bet they love that. It's all synthesizers.
Yeah, I know. I know. Now, with your next album being having a number of songs that you already recorded on it,
mm-hmm,
does that mean you have a bunch of songs saved up for another album?
Oh, or? Yeah. We have a backlog of songs. In fact, we were supposed to go in and do a new album in August. And at the beginning of August, I made a decision to change from the Nashville office of MCA to the Los Angeles office of MCA, to the pop division at, mm-hmm, MCA. And so I wanted to do one more album for the Nashville office.
Yeah.
And we were scheduled to do, you know, the album of entirely new material. And instead of doing that, Tony Brown and I said, hey, let's go to Houston and do this record that the fans have been writing and asking for. And so that's what we did. We went home and did this One Fair Summer Evening album.
I wanted to ask you something about that process of writing with other people, if I could go back to that for a
sure.
minute. Are you initiating that process, or is somebody else coming to you and saying, I have a song I haven't completed, or...
The only time that someone else has come to me with the concept of a song was Bobby Nelson came to me with the concept of More Than a Whisper.
Mm-hmm.
And then we went out and drank wine all night and wrote the song on napkins in a bar in the in Austin. In fact, in the Texas Chili Parlor in Austin down on Lavaca Street. And the rest of the time, it's always been something that I've started, like Tom Russell wrote one line in Outbound Plane. He was sitting in my living room drinking whiskey one day, and I was working on the song, and he said, hey, how about this, you know? And so ended up collaborating on a song rather involuntarily, you know?
Yeah.
And the other times, it's been something I've already been working on. Eric Taylor and I co-wrote Ghost in the Music, and I was working on the song, and I went to him, and I said, I really wish you'd contribute to this because it's your type of song. You know, so it's been collaboration in different ways.
Are a lot of people sending you songs?
Oh, yeah. We get a lot of songs in the mail. And a lot of people send me lyrics, and it's just so rare, you know, that I find a song that way. Every song that I've ever recorded by another artist that isn't my song has been a song that I've learned in my living room at 3 o'clock in the morning with 10 people sitting around trading guitars. And someone says, listen to this new song. And that's where I've learned Once in a Very Blue Moon. That's where I learned Going Gone. You know, all the songs practically. Roseville Fair of Bill Staines. So.
Bill Staines was... Someone, I understand, encouraged you to take your music outside of Texas.
Very much so. Very much so. And gave him liberal credit for that on this new album. We did Roseville Fair for the album, the live version of Roseville Fair. So.
Our guest is Nanci Griffith, and her albums are on MCA, her most recent albums, and a new one coming out shortly. How about another song? People have been telling me about this Nicaragua song. Oh, you did it. It's on the album, right? Wing and...
It's on the Last of the True Believers album, the Wing and the Wheel song.
Yeah. Would you do that for us? Or feel like doing it? Or?
Yeah, I'll have to retune. Do you want me to do Love at the Five and Dime while I'm still in tune?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. All right. You got it.
Not here. She made the Woolworth counter shine. And Eddie was a sweet romancer and a darn good dancer. And they'd waltz the aisles of the Five and Dime. And they'd sing, dance a little closer to me. They'd dance a little closer now. Dance a little closing time and love's on sale tonight at Eddie played the steel guitar, and his mama cried cause he played in the bars, and he kept young Rita out late at night. So they married up in Abilene, lost a child in Tennessee, and still that love survived, cause it seemed it's a little closer to me. Dance a little closer now. Dance a little closer tonight. Dance a little closer to me. Hey, it's closing time and love's on sale tonight at this fair night. One of the boys in Eddie's band, he took a shine to Rita's hand. So Eddie ran off with the basement's wife. Oh, but he was back by June, singing a different tune, sporting Miss Rita back by side. And he sang, dance a little closer to me. Yeah, dance a little closer now. Dance a little closer. It's a little closer to me. It's closing time and love's on sale tonight at this 5 and 9. Eddie traveled with the barroom band till arthritis took his hands. Now he sells insurance on the side. And Rita's got her house to keep. She writes dime store novels of a love so sweet. They dance to the radio late at night and still sing. It's a little closer to me. Dance a little closer now. Dance a little closer tonight. Dance a little closer to me. It's closing time and love's on sale tonight at this fair night. Cause Rita was 16 years, hazel eyes and chestnut hair. Really made the whole world count to shine. And Eddie was a sweet romancer and a darn good dancer. And they'd waltz the aisles of the 5 and 9. And they lived a mighty simple life, cause they'd go waltz the aisles of the 5 and 9. We could all go with Howard and Ross tomorrow and go waltz the aisles of the 5 and 9.
Oh, that's such a great song.
Thank you.
I love the way you sing, too.
Thanks.
You know, I see the pictures as I hear that song. I wonder why somebody doesn't make a movie of that song.
Oh, it would make a great movie, I think. Yeah. What lovely characters Eddie and Rita are.
Is that your favorite kind of song, to write those stories?
Oh, yeah. I love writing those type of songs. You know, they're my favorite to write, actually.
Is it a problem, or is it the hard work of the song to get it all condensed into the time a song takes, the whole story?
It was with Love at the 5 and 9. I wrote it for a workshop up in Canada at a folk festival where a bunch of us were in a songwriter's workshop, and we were supposed to do songs about musicians' domestic life on the road. And Eddie and Rita, the characters from Love and the 5 and 9, are the main characters in one of my short stories. So the night before the workshop, I wrote Love at the 5 and 9.
and condensed that short story into the 3.5 minutes of Love at the Five and Dime. And the interesting part was is that I stayed up all night writing that song, and when I got to the workshop, not a one of those dadgum other songwriters did a song about a musician's domestic life on the road. Everybody did what the dadgum wanted to, you know, and I'd stayed up all night and prepared something, you know. But it was worth it for me because I got that little jewel out of it, you know.
Is that a common practice for you to challenge yourself to, here's a subject, here's what I want to do with it? Is that the way you work?
Sometimes. There have been a couple of songs lately. James Hooker and I just finished writing a song called Radio Fragile, which is strictly a keyboard song. Mm-hmm. He wrote the music. I can't even play it on guitar yet, but I wrote the lyrics, and it's a song about Phil Oakes. And that was a particular subject that I'd always wanted to write about. And it's written from a very different perspective, I think. So that'll be on the next album. Mm-hmm. That kind of, we go into the studio in January to start, you know, a new album of all new material. And that'll be the title cut from the album. So things like that, I mean, special projects like that are really interesting for me and challenging.
Let me ask you a little bit about Texas songwriters. They seem so supportive of one another. It's a phenomenon I can only relate to Texas. In the time we've been doing this program, we've had people like Stephen Fromholtz and Michael Martin Murphy and Jimmy Dale Gilmore and Butch Hancock and all they do is talk about other Texas songwriters.
Uh-huh. I think that's really true. The first time that I went over to Europe, I had a lot of people tell me, I heard of you through Gary P. Nunn, or I heard of you through Joe Ely, or, you know, it was always another fellow Texan who had spread word abroad. So, you know, that I think is true. We kind of stick together.
Our guest is Nanci Griffith, and she records for MCA Records. And I'm looking forward to it. Maybe next time you come through with the band, you'll be doing the song about Phil Oakes. Cause
I'm sure we will be.
I was a great fan of his. One of the things I always thought that people didn't recognize was how musical he was. They got so bowled over by the lyrics that they never took into account just how musical and patriotic he was.
He was a great melody maker. You know, he really did write beautiful melodies.
Never did hit me till I saw him in person.
Yeah.
What song are you going to do next?
This is a tune that inspired by a group from Nicaragua, from Managua, called Duo Guadabaranco. And we had done Canadian festivals all the way across Canada 3 years ago together and got to know each other and became friends. And I was watching them play in Vancouver the last night that I would see them on through all the festivals. And this little moon hanging out over the stage. And they had 50,000 people mesmerized and hanging from that little fingernail moon up in the sky with the ocean on one side and the mountains on the other. And they didn't even sing one song in English, never spoke a word of English. But 50,000 people who couldn't understand Spanish sat there and were totally enthralled by these beautiful harmonies. And their friendship and seeing them go back to Nicaragua, knowing I wouldn't see them for a long time and that our countries were at odds, inspired this next song. And it's a tune called The Wing and the Wheel.
Things away, whether it's me that does the leaving or the love that flies away. And the moon outside my window looks so lonely tonight. There is a chunk out of its middle that's big enough for an old fool to hide. where their dreams are in their children again. There's a pale sky in the east, all the stars are in the west. Oh, and here's to all the dreamers, may our open hearts find rest. 'Cause the wing and the wheel carry us along, and we'll have memories for company. Oh, it's long after the songs are sung, and it's so
Nanci, I should have asked you this a little earlier. So there was an obvious place to ask this question, but I forgot it then. When you went to Ireland, did you feel a certain kinship with the people there?
Well, they make you feel that way. Ireland has just been incredible to me and the Blue Moon Orchestra. My records are gold there. We sell out 6 nights in a row at the Olympia Theatre in Dublin, just 18,000 seats. It's a marvelous feeling, and I'm not Irish. I'm Welsh, but I know back there somewhere there's a little bit of Irish, you know, coming through, and I guess there's a great propinquity amongst tarts there between the Irish and the type of music that they love and the type of music that I write and play. Mary Black has recorded 2 of my songs, and Mara O'Connell has recorded a couple of my songs. Both of them, of course, used to sing with Dadannan and now have their own wonderful solo careers. Mary just went platinum in Ireland, you know. So, lovely ladies. By the time I got to Ireland, between Mara and Mary Black, the audiences knew all my songs, you know. It's just lovely.
That's great. We have time for 2 more songs. I wonder if you feel like doing 2 more?
Sure. Be glad to. Well, it wouldn't be an evening if this song didn't get done. This is a tune by Pat Alger, and it's called Once in a Very Blue Moon. I found your letter in my mailbox today. You were just checking if I was okay. And if I miss you, well, you know what they say. Just once in a very blue moon. Just once in a very blue moon. Just once in a very blue moon. And I be one coming on soon. No need to tell me you'd like to be friends. Help me get back on my feet again. And if I miss you, well, just now and then, just once in a very blue moon. Just once in a very blue moon. Just once in a very blue moon. And I'll be one coming on soon. There's a blue moon shining when I am reminded of all we've been through. Such a blue like I'm the only one who's getting up from a fall. Don't you remember, can't you recall? Just once, it's in a very blue moon. Just once in a very blue moon. Just once in a very blue moon. And I feel one coming on soon. Just once in a very
people like Pat Alger and Tom Russell and all the rest of your songwriting friends know exactly what you look for in a song, so that when they send you something, it's something that you feel like maybe they're reading your mind?
Well, I accused Pat Alger of reading my mail for a long time while I was out on the road breaking into my mailbox. And I really think he did it for a long time. We had three songs right in a row, Once a Very Blue Moon, Going Gone, and Lone Star State of Mind, that just hit straight to the heart. And Robert Earl Keen as well. Robert Earl Keen Jr., I've recorded now, Sing One for Sister of His, and I Would Change My Life on the Little Love Affairs album, both of which hit me straight in the heart. So, you know, that it could be that those guys read my mind or have Jack Webb characters that follow me around on the road.
I've thought about asking you this, and it seems like a silly question because I don't know how it can be answered, but if you had to verbalize what it is you're looking for in a song, is there any way you could do that? I mean,
that's a real hard thing to answer, because I've had people that have given me tapes and sent me songs that they said they wrote specifically for me, and I would play it, and it would be a lovely song, but it wouldn't be something that Nanci Griffith would really sing. And so I know that when I look at a song, there can't even be one line of lyric that I find disagreeable. You know, every line of the song has to have an impact. It has to be so concentrated. And that's always been very important. I guess that's the most important. Mm. And that it's fun to sing.
I kind of wondered about, you know, I'm sure there are a lot of songs you like but don't feel are suited to your voice or your range or whatever, all the technical stuff, I guess.
Oh, plenty of things. Yeah, I mean, I've always been a big fan of Patsy Cline, but I would never try to sing "I Fall to Pieces" or "Crazy," because they're just not Nanci Griffith songs. You know, I would sound really silly trying to sing those songs. So I think that there are a lot of things that I admire that I don't sing. I'm an enormous fan of Tom Waits, but I've never done any of Tom's songs either, because the character is him. You know, it's his thing.
Our guest is Nanci Griffith, and we have time for one more song.
Great, I should do this. This is my all-time favorite of my things that I've written. And, of course, Rosalie Sorrells has been recovering up in Boise, Idaho of an illness, and this song goes out to her. This was written while I was on tour with Rosalie. Rosalie Sorrells and Nina Gerber and I were out in a Ford Econoline van, which brought on Rosalie to tell us all about her leaving home in 1963 from Salt Lake City in a Ford Econoline van with five restless children, to say the least. And this song came about as a fictional account of Rosalie's great escape and goes out respectfully to her and also to the memory of Kate Wolfe, because Kate said of this song that Forget Rosalie, mine was a Dodge. So here we go. 40 Connelline and Howard and Roz, thank you for having me on. Well, she drove west from Salt Lake City to the California coastline. She hit the San Diego freeway doing 60 miles an hour. She had a husband on her boat. She had five restless children. And she was singing as sweet as a mockingbird in that 40 Connelline. And she is so with sheep and man as a lion, but his big mistake was in buying her that 40 Connelline. 'Cause she is a soldier, yeah, she is straight from the bosom of the Mormon church, with a voice like a wine, a-cruising along in that 40 Connelline. After singing the songs around this country, from Seattle to Montgomery, hey, those kids are grown, and that around the nose you cannot cage your wife. All on the back of roads of our nation,
Nanci, once again, we want to thank you for dropping by. I really appreciate it. And hope you can come by again when you're a big, big star. I know you're going to be.
Oh, shoot. Thanks. Thanks for having me.